places that you can give this morning so that you guys don't bunch up and become dangerous. And so, hallelujah, too late, right? Let's all stand together and let's make this offering declaration. As we receive today's offering, we are believing the Lord for jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, debts paid off, expenses decrease, blessing and increase. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of my financial needs, that I may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. I almost jumped in with that hallelujah too fast. Amen. Praise God. And I'm believing for some of those things that I'm decreeing. Amen. So God is faithful. We are live on Facebook, and you're more than welcome to share that and put that on so that those who aren't able to come, or we've got a lot of people from other cities and places telling us that they've been watching with us. So that's an exciting thing. Amen. We're allowing to reach out to other people. Amen. So at this time, we're going to dismiss the kids' church and nursery and to go to that, have a good time, learn a lot, move in the things of God. Amen. As God is raising up a new generation. Praise God. And yes, ma'am. Yes. All right. So let's pray for Lisa Phillips. She fell this morning. So Father, we just ask you extend your hand to touch Lisa. Lord, we just ask for grace and healing to be extended to her right now. Father, let healing rise up in her, God. In Jesus' name, we agree together, Father. Amen. Amen. Praise God. All right, so I'm sorry to hear that. All right. Praise the Lord. Continue to pray for them, and we'll try to get a report on that and share with everybody. Whole middle section just cleared out. There's, what happened? There's a few of you here, but hallelujah. They're all children. Everybody, the children and the children's workers all left. So hallelujah. God's good, amen. And I'm just thankful for what he's doing. And, you know, I know that we're even hearing reports, and I know some of you have seen on Facebook that even the very site where, George Foreman. I thought you said George Foreman. I was like, no, that's not right. He has a good grill. But where George Floyd was murdered, there's a revival breaking out. And people are getting born again and baptized. And the really interesting thing about that is the pastor who's kind of overseeing that, about 9 or 10 years ago, I was even actually at a small leaders meeting in his church in Minneapolis, and his name's Dr. Charles Karuku, and an African-American man, African guy who's immigrated to the United States, and a really quality guy. And after that happened, they just went into that area, and God's just doing good things, amen. And so we're thankful that in the midst of turmoil, and God's doing something. So let's continue to pray for revival and awakening and justice and righteousness in our nation in every area. Amen. So this morning I want to talk about, and this might be a good connection even to what Jamie will be teaching tomorrow night in the Supernatural School, but I want to talk about the heart of the new creation, okay? And I'm going to put my teaching hat on this morning. We may read a lot of scripture. So just, I guess I should have done a PowerPoint, but y'all are, you know, you can do a Bible drill or at least punch in numbers on your phone, okay? But this morning, there's a question that I think comes up a lot in modern Christianity. And that question is, should we follow our heart? Do you ever hear anybody say that? Well, just follow your heart, okay? Especially, and I'm not picking on it, but women's ministry, that's a big one. You should just follow your heart, okay? Well, and then it's popular to say that you should follow the desires of your heart. And people even quote scripture about that, right? Psalm 37:4, man, we like to quote that when we want something, right? Delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. I really want that new car. It's a desire of my heart. I really want that person or that ideal of that person, right? And God's going to give me the desires of my heart, right? I'm wanting a righteous fox. And Lord, you know my heart. You know, I want a man with good teeth, right? And muscles and a big bank account, some ladies say, right? All right? What we forget about is the first part of that verse. Delight yourself in the Lord, right? And he will give you the desires of your heart. I think that scripture means that as we're delighting in the Lord, we begin to love what he loves. And we begin to hate what he hates. And that causes us to move close to his heart. So we have that scripture, and then we've got another scripture, Jeremiah 17:9. The heart is more deceitful than all else and is desperately sick. Who can understand it? So what the heck? Those scriptures absolutely contradict each other. What do you do? Well, you know what the best way to interpret scripture is? Other scripture, context, because you can create any doctrine out of any scripture, right? You can pick out, cherry pick, and we're bad about that in the modern church. We cherry pick a scripture to prove a doctrine that when you look at the whole of scripture is ridiculous, right? So this morning I want to look at the doctrine of the heart of the new creation, amen. So, you know, this scripture in Jeremiah 17:9, really, the context is that Jeremiah is talking about Judah in their apostasy and their backslidden condition. Now, how many of you know if you are in apostasy, let's just call it like it is, if you're in apostasy or you're in a backslidden condition, there's probably a little bit of wickedness in your heart, right? Okay? There's some truth to that, okay? But the reality is, that is an old covenant scripture. Now hang on, okay? I promise you I'm not going to teach you heresy this morning, right? But the reality is that both Jeremiah, Jamie's looking at me like, I don't know about that, right? The reality is that both Jeremiah and Ezekiel prophesied about a day that was coming when the people of God would have a new heart and a new spirit, and that God would write his law, his ways, his character on their hearts, and that suddenly what was difficult in the Old Testament would suddenly become natural and normal in the new covenant. Okay? So some of you, Jamie's still looking at me like, I don't know. Right, let's look at Jeremiah 31:33, okay? Let's turn to Jeremiah 31:33. Y'all just hang with me here. Jeremiah is prophesying, this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after these days. And Jeremiah is like, listen, you're deceitful right now, your heart's filled with wickedness, but after these days, there will come a moment when I will make a covenant with the house of Israel, and I will put my law within them and on their hearts, and I will write it, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Now today, if you're a born-again believer, God's written his law on your heart, and he's made a covenant with you, and it has become your new normal. Everybody's talking about the new normal, right? You know what your normal is in the new covenant as a believer? Is that you hunger and thirst for righteousness. Because you are living in a new covenant, new creation reality. Anybody ever grow up in church where you were taught how rotten and awful and terrible you were? And sinful? Right? Maybe your husband and wife still teach you, tell you that. Right? The reality was when you became born again, God wrote his law on your heart. Right? His spirit now indwells you as a born-again believer, and you are a totally new creation that hungers and thirsts after righteousness. Amen? Here's another scripture, Ezekiel 36. Let's turn there. We're close. Just turn over a couple of books to Ezekiel 36, verses 26 and 27. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances. God says, I'm going to remove that stony heart out of you that opposes God and opposes his ways. And I'm going to put my spirit and my heart within you, and I'm going to put my law within you, and the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. And you're going to live for me. You're going to pursue me because it's going to be your normal. Right? Your normal now is that you are a new creation that hunger and thirst for righteousness. You hunger and thirst for the word of God. You hunger and thirst for the presence of God. You hunger and thirst for the ways of God, to know God. That's who you are, right? By the Spirit, by the Word, amen? Now, this, we're living in this day. You no longer have a wicked heart, amen? Look at your spouse or your significant other or your child and say, or your friend, and say that you don't have a wicked heart anymore. You have a renewed heart. Amen. So this new nature, some of you are like, I'm speaking by faith. I'm calling things that are not as though they are. Right? Now we laugh at that, but you know, that's a big part of faith. You know, a lot of us had a lot of really good word of faith teaching. It was great foundational teaching that taught us how to move in faith. Now, some of us backed away because of some of the excesses, right? You know, Papa Hagen, before he died, actually rebuked the word of faith movement. Said, y'all are in extremes. Get it together. So the principles of something can be really good, but that doesn't mean that a doctrine is, or a truth is no longer good when we get into excesses. You got to be careful not to throw the baby out with the bathwater, okay? So those concepts of faith, of calling things into existence and living in that is a basic understanding of Christian living, right? And if we begin to actually believe that we are a new creation, guess what happens? As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. If you start believing every day, well, man, I'm wicked. I'm wicked. I'm just going to live in wickedness. You start thinking like that, what do you start doing? You start living in it, right? But if you start having the understanding, and we're going to get there in a minute, where you start sowing to the new nature, right, it begins to cause us to live in righteousness, right? Because sometimes, you know, we sow things and want a different harvest than what we sow. And we're shocked when we sow unrighteousness or unbelief, right, or lack, and then we're shocked when we harvest those things back. If you want a good harvest, you got to sow good seed in the soil of your heart. Because how many of you know your heart is good seed? I want you to say that with me. My heart is good seed. Right? Your heart, your life is made up of good soil of the kingdom. And so whatever you sow in it is going to sow, is going to grow really fast. Therefore, grasshopper, you must choose wisely. You must sow wisely into your heart. Guard over your heart. Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it will flow the springs of life. Right? Now, they're not as popular as they used to be, but remember when soap operas were really popular? Some of you do. Right? Or as my grandparents called it, our stories. We got to watch our stories today, right? What happens when housewives live in the fantasy of soap operas? Why is my husband not named Steel? Or Rock? Right? Something soap opera name, you know. And why does he not look like that? Right? You live in that fantasy realm. And right, your husband comes home and they're like, it's you. Look at you. You don't look like Steel. And he's like, no, I've been under houses all day, fixing lines filled with poop, right? that's the reality, right? So what we put in our mind, the thought process, because you could live in fantasy and not live in reality, right? And he comes home and he says, well, you don't look like Scarlet either. Right? Yeah. Hallelujah. But a new nature will enable us to walk the way God intended us to walk. And it's natural. Right? It's your normal, right? Paul even refers to that in 2 Corinthians 3:3, and you can look at that in a little bit later, but he said, you know, you're the letter that we've written by the Spirit of God on your heart, right? There's the Spirit of God has made you a letter, and he's writing something, right? He's referring to this new creation, new covenant reality that you've become. Now, sometimes we try to take the pen out of the Holy Spirit's hand. And we try to write a reality that the Spirit of God's like, wait a minute. Let me write a new covenant, new creation reality on your life. Partner with me. Quit taking the pen out of my hand. Right? And so, in this new creation, your heart's not wicked. It is new and renewed. And this is true the moment you got saved. Now, unfortunately, a lot of people get saved and they don't know this. And they're just like, I'm just a dirty, rotten sinner. Now, you can still sin, right? God doesn't force anything. But it is your normal nature to pursue him and live in righteousness. You just have to tend the garden of your heart. Okay? Your heart is good ground and has brought forth good fruit from the word of the kingdom. Amen. Let's turn to Matthew 13:23. We're getting in the New Testament now. Everybody gets uncomfortable when you get in the Old Testament. Right? Let's move out of all those judgments and get where Jesus is turning water into wine, right? Matthew 13:23. 13:23. For those of you on the camera, on Facebook, I am not advocating drunkenness. So, right. Those of you present, it's okay. No, I'm kidding. Just kidding, right? We're under grace, right? So, Matthew 13:23, and the one on whom seed was sown on the good soil, this is the man or the woman who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and brings forth some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. Amen. Now, your heart became good ground when someone sowed the seed of the word of, the, of God in your life. And God, by his Spirit, was drawing you. Right? Now, I'm not a Calvinist. Okay? You don't know what that is? Another time. Right? But you got saved because the Spirit of God was drawing you. Right? Now, you still had a choice, but he drew you with grace. Okay? He gave you actually faith, and you received the seed of the Word of God in your heart, and you were born again by an incorruptible seed of the Word of God. And your heart became new, and it became good ground. And so, as the Word of God gets sown into our lives, right, you can produce 30-fold. 30-fold's good, isn't it? How many of you knew if you had an investment that you could invest and get 30-fold back, how many of you would do it? Risk-free, right? We do it. Some 60-fold. That's even better. Some 100-fold, right? 30's good, 60's great, but I want the 100-fold in my life. And I'm not just talking about money, though. That's great. I want that, right? I want to be a blessing in the kingdom, right? You know, but I want righteousness to spring up in my heart 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. Because the reality is my heart's good ground. I watch over it. Amen. And sometimes I'm like, oh, there's something growing. I don't like it. Right? There's some weeds in my garden. I've let some unforgiveness and bitterness grow up. So, ooh. Let's pull that out, that root of bitterness, unless it springs up and by it many are defiled. The Word talks about that because those things don't just defile us. They defile everybody around us. Because how many of you know when we have stuff growing in our heart that's not good, we sometimes vomit it on other people. We do that, right? And so the reality is, and you start understanding, my heart is good ground. God, I'm rejoicing in that I have a new creation heart. Right? I'm not deceitfully wicked. Say that today. I'm not deceitfully wicked. Right? Right? You're a new creation reality, and it begins to change your perspective and your understanding, because you can still sin if you choose to. Because again, God gives us choice, right? The problem is the kingdom runs on this thing of reaping and sowing. And so if you sow good seed in good ground, you get a good return. But if you sow bad seed in good ground, you still get a return. Right? And so sometimes we're like, oh, I'm sowing unbelief. And so what do you get? Unbelief. Has this been a difficult season, and is this still a difficult season in our nation? And I told Jamie the other day, you know, and I'm not denying the reality of COVID-19, but I said, you know what? I would rather go live my life and die. Does that mean we not be careful? Yes, we should be careful and all those things. Right? But I'd just rather go live my life and die if I have to. Right? Now, I don't want any of y'all to die. lived these last weeks. And again, that's not to say that we don't be careful and take precautions. Wash your hands. Right? Always. Even when there's not a pandemic. It's just good hygiene, right? You know, but we sow fear, and so does faith come out? No, it doesn't, you know. And so we have the choice of what we're sowing in our heart, because God's given you a new heart and a new spirit. Now, so the question is, we talk about this and we make these confessions, and sometimes people are like, well, then why do I still sometimes want to do what's wrong, right? Why do I still sometimes sin or want to sin or have a desire for those things, or, you know, I'm greedy, you know, or I'm a gossip and I can't control myself, right? I do, you know. But because really, here's the thing. Before we got saved, amen, we grew up in this world and we have been conditioned mentally to sin. And did you know that if you don't guard your heart and your mind, that every day you can, the world is conditioning you to think and act like them? Right? Whether it's, you know, movies, media, songs, Facebook, Twitter, you know, Snapchat, TikTok, right? There's this pressure, you know, that to Jim's like, what? He's asking Martha, what's that? She's like, I'll tell you later. But there's this pressure to live unrighteously. And it's constant, you know. And even, you know, some stuff I've read this week, even about, even some very ungodly people in media have finally said, you know, y'all are really dumb. Because, I'm sorry, if you're not a woman, you can't have the experience of a woman. And it was J.K. Rowling, the lady who wrote Harry Potter. And she just got attacked. And you know what she said? I don't care. I'm not apologizing. And they left her alone. Now it keeps trying to crop back up, you know. We've got, what, the pastor, Church of the Highlands in Birmingham, Alabama, who likes some tweets by President Trump and lost his lease, and they shut his free clinic down because he had an opinion. Yeah, he liked a couple of Trump's tweets, which is like roadkill, right? What did you say? Oh my gosh, this is hilarious. I'm going to like it. I don't know. I'm speculating, right? Again, I'm saying all that to say there's this intense pressure on us to be unrighteous. And if you're not choosing unrighteousness, you get attacked by the hive mind of Twitter. If you're not choosing righteousness, sorry, I misspoke, I guess. Right? So the world tries to squeeze us. Isn't it funny when you go back and you look at what you wore 30 years ago? You're wearing it again today, right? Some of us still have those things in our closet. Right? Jamie, man, when we got married, I was like, what's that shirt? I've been looking for that shirt for like a month. And she's like, yeah, I threw that away. Yeah. But you look back at what you wore 30 years ago because media told you it was, you know, really cool. It was really happening. It was groovy. It was the bee's knees. It was rad. It was bitchin', right?
We said that, didn't we? The 80s kids here on the front row are like, mm-hmm. We're California kids, right? It doesn't mean that, just for Facebook Live. And you know, now when I look at a picture of myself in parachute pants with a permed mullet, it is hilarious. And I'm like, what was I thinking? And I didn't even have social media then. I just had friends. And, you know, right? So some of y'all in 30 years, you're going to look at your social media pictures and you're like, good God. What was I thinking? Oh, that's really fun, right? It's okay. It's okay. You know, I may get a permed mullet again. I don't know. Right? We look really strange right now. I'm just saying. I'm going to need a weave. Right? I'm just. Yeah, we might just do it. There is a shop over here, I think, where you can get a weave and weed. Medical marijuana dispensary. So, Weave and Weed is the name, I think. But you know, I'll give you the address later. I am really getting off track, right? But we've been taught the world's value system. We've been taught, and even in the church, we're bombarded with what the value system of the world is. And it's sometimes shocking where we go, you know, because these things are being sown into us, and we're letting them into the good ground of our heart. Right? That's why, parents, you are so important. You're so important. You are the first and last line of defense. And I hate to say it that way because I don't think of in defense, but offense, that we're on the offense of putting things into the lives of our children and our grandchildren and our family, because, you know, good things can, you know, you can put your kid in a Christian school because you want them to receive stuff, but never live in righteousness yourself. And so ultimately, your children will do like you do and not as you say. You know? So parental influence is so important. We have to teach kingdom values and systems, right, into the lives of our children and our grandchildren. Because when our mind is unrenewed, okay, it's at war with God's ways. Right? You can be born again and truly born again and never, ever renew your mind and absolutely live and have the fruit of an unsaved person. You can be truly born again and live in fear, lack, sickness, right, sin, and then wonder why you're miserable. Some of us have just enough of God to be miserable. Right? We get enough of God to see the kingdom, but we don't live in the reality of the kingdom. Right? And God's wanting us to live successful, righteous, overcoming kingdom lives. Now that's a process. Because you can be an overcomer and still have a bad season. You can be an overcomer and righteous and still live in moments of difficulty. Right? It's those moments when you're just like, God, you're still God. You're still God in the midst of this, and I still worship you. and I still trust you even when it's difficult. Right? That often is where some of the greatest transformation happens, because you're sowing seed of trust even when it's buried and you don't see the fruit of it coming up. Right? Because when you sow seed, there is an element of faith. When you plant a garden, right? You sow stuff with the faith that it's going to grow. But don't you dare. We try, right? We've done that before with no success. But how many of you know that you have to do things to help the seed grow? That was the problem, right? You know, it's the same way, and this is so elementary, but how many of you know where we really miss it is in the little things? Right? That's why if you do any inner healing or deliverance with Dwayne, he's generally going to give you homework. Right? You can have an incredible moment where you get set free of something that's been binding you, lets you go. But if you don't do the homework, you still have the same value system and the same thought process, and you go back into bondage, and you open the door, and a devil comes back in and brings seven other spirits, and your condition is worse. Hallelujah. This is a cheerful message, right? But the reality is this. We've got to sow things in our heart, in our life, because we're a new creation reality with good ground, right? All right, I want to turn to Romans 8. Romans chapter 8, verses 5 and 6. I told you I was going to put on my teaching hat today, and here we go. For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mindset on the Spirit is life and peace. Amen? If we're sowing things of the Spirit, we're sowing heavenly things, things of good fruit and good character, that's what's going to come up. I mean, Jamie's been talking about that in supernatural school, right? You know, because there is this kingdom reality that whatever we're sowing, we're reaping. And again, the whole reason God did that, because that's a universal law. It's a natural law. The reason God set that in motion was because he wanted us to live in greater blessing. He wanted our children to live in greater blessing than we did. He wanted our grandchildren to live in greater blessing, because we're constantly sowing to righteousness. We're constantly living in kingdom dynamics, and so there's a multi-generational thing that's happening, and there's a successive flow, because revival should get greater in every generation. Right? Awakening. We shouldn't have to go back and look at the mistakes that our parents and our grandparents and our great-grandparents made where they missed it. Now, praise God, we can learn from some of those things, because we're all going to miss it in certain areas. But one of the things that we're learning is there's a generational momentum of blessing. And again, I'm not just talking about money and material things, because sometimes when we talk about blessing, but when we're talking about shalom and peace that's breaking the power of chaos and it's causing us to live in righteousness and justice and blessing and the goodness of God, amen, from every generation to every generation, right? That's what God desires. He wants us to learn to sow those things. It starts now, right? Every moment we choose, God, I'm going to sow the Spirit. I'm going to sow the things of the Spirit. My mind is going to be set on the things of the Spirit. Amen. And that's how God wants us to live, because the mind set on the flesh can actually cause wickedness. right? And our mind can be renewed and brought into unity and harmony with our recreated heart, right? And that's why we can be born again and still struggle, right? Haven't you had to choose faith in these last days? Right? Haven't you had to choose peace at times? Right? In these last days of COVID-19 and all these things, and you're just like, God, I'm choosing to trust you. I don't know if my business is going to collapse. Right? And if it does, God, I'm still choosing to trust you. Right? Still choosing to love you and follow you, because he's still good even when bad things happen. Right? Now, what purifies the heart? Amen. Let's turn to Acts 15. Let's turn to Acts 15. How many of you want to have a pure heart? Turn to your spouse and say, you need that. No, don't do that. You might get in trouble. Right. Acts 15, verses 8 and 9. Okay. And God, who knows the heart, bore witness to them, giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he also did to us. And he made no distinction between us and them. Cleansing, my translation says that, some say purifying, cleansing. And purifying their hearts by what? Faith. So there's an element that faith purifies your heart. Right? There's a pursuit of faith that will actually cause your heart to be purified. Right? And again, let's think about what faith is. Is faith just believing the right thing? I mentally agree with Scripture. So does the devil. You know what scriptural faith really is? Is hearing from God and doing what he says, regardless of what comes against you. That's faith. Study Scripture sometime. Every major character in Scripture, God spoke to them. Noah, go build an ark. It's going to rain. What? What's an ark? What's rain? Okay, God, I'll do it. He did it for years and years, and people mocked him, told him he was crazy. Abraham, leave your country where you are. And I'm going to go, and I'm going to give you this land, and look at the stars. Your descendants are going to be more numerous than the stars, Abraham. What, God? Who are you? Right? Paul on the road to Damascus. Hey, Paul, guess what? You just got knocked off your horse and you can't see. And everything that you've been living your life for is wrong. You're a chosen instrument. And guess what? I'm going to use you. What? Who is this, Lord? I've been wrong. Right? And all of these people went through great obstacles because they were met by God. Right? And he met them and he spoke to them and they said, God, I'm following you even through difficulty. Right? There's a purifying of our hearts that happen by faith. So you start walking a faith walk, you'll get challenged. Right? But as you follow God in what he said, even when there's difficulty, and you choose him and you choose his ways, there's something that happens because you're sowing obedience and righteousness into your heart. And you know what? Sometimes it can be an uncomfortable process. But that's the faith walk. Believing those things that are not and calling them into manifestation as though they were. Right? Man, don't to create something righteous in kingdom when there was nothing there before? Right? When you're like, God, years ago, the Lord spoke to Jamie, I want you to start a church or a school. She didn't want a church, no. She put this burden on her for a Christian school in Ardmore, Oklahoma. It took a while before that came into manifestation. And we started before we even knew we were going to start. And all this started happening, and we had those 13 students in that storefront where all the dead birds died in the roof. It was glorious, you know. And that whole journey, it was a journey of faith. Still is. I mean, we're in this moment where we're like, Lord, what's the fall going to look like? We all going to be wearing masks? What, right? But there's something that we said, are we even going to be allowed to have school? Right? I mean, it is before the elections. Sorry, that was a political thing I'm not supposed to do. Right? But there's this faith walk when you believe every day and you start establishing something in the spirit, right? You start establishing this kingdom structure that can change generations, right? You start building something in the spirit. And Chuck Pierce says before you ever go into a territory and start establishing something, you have to build around the presence of God. You have to start establishing kingdom. You're sowing those things. Amen. And you pursue that. And that faith walk, it believing God changes the conditions of your heart. So if today you're like, I don't know that I'm believing. Right? Start believing. Right? Start reading the Word. Did you know there's something even about confessing the Word? And some of us have kind of put that aside because we're like, I did that 30 years ago. Guess what? It's still in. Still declaring those things. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I'm a new creation. I have a new heart. I hunger and thirst for righteousness. Right? We're declaring those things by faith, amen. We're declaring those things in our thoughts and our thinking, amen. Because one other scripture I want to look at, Hebrews 3:12. Let's turn there. Take care, brethren. Now, we should always really pay attention when Scripture says, take care, brethren, lest there should be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart in falling away from the living God. Now, my Baptist background tries to look at that through a lens. And I'm not getting into the theology of all that. But you can be born again and have unbelief in your heart that causes you to fall away from God. Right? And that can be nothing more than, Lord, you may be even going through the motions of Christianity. Right? But you're not choosing to believe Him. And that's a scary place to be. Does that mean you're going to go to heaven, hell? No. That's not my topic today. Maybe I'll get on that someday, since I just wrote a paper about hell. Hallelujah. I made a B, right? So I don't know how good it was, but I learned a lot, right? But the reality is we are to guard our heart from unbelief. What does unbelief look like? God, I'm not going to follow you. God, I'm not going to believe what you've said. God, I'm not going to believe your promises. I may say that I am, but in my heart of hearts, am I believing you? Am I pursuing you? Am I walking after you? Am I believing your promises? Am I walking in faith? Those prophetic words that you spoke to me, and Lord, they seem impossible. Am I believing you? And there are moments when, obviously, there's some days that I'm like, I don't believe it, God. But you know, it's in those moments that you get back up and you get around people that are filled with faith and can encourage you. You get in the Word. You read Scripture. Again, Scripture is still in. It's still essential. Now, I love the presence of God. I love to soak in the presence of God. But I still need the Word of God. Right? And that's when you encourage yourself. And that's when you read stories of people like George Mueller and John G. Lake, right? And Amy Simple McPherson and Catherine Kuhlman and Oral Roberts and Bill Johnson and Heidi Baker and Randy Clark and Billy Graham. And you go back and you read those things and you're like, man, there's a great cloud of witnesses. There's a great cloud that are standing and they're watching and they're cheering me on and they're saying, you believe one more day. You fix your eyes on the King. You put the eyes of your heart, the expectation, the flow, put it on the King today. Because he's faithful. And you may die believing the promise. But you know what? If you do, you're in good company. I want to be in the hall of faith because even though I may not have seen everything that I believe for, I stood believing. And I went after it. And I pursued it. I don't want to be in the hall of those who gave up. Because that was not how I was created to live. That is not the new creation reality that is in each one of you. There's something, if you've been born again, and it's, let's be honest, it just gets better when you've been filled with the Holy Spirit. When I got filled with the Holy Spirit, I was like, ooh, I think I've been born again. All right? You know? And then I get filled with the Spirit again. And it's still good, right? But I just like, God, I'm sowing into the new heart. I'm sowing righteousness. I'm renewing my mind. I'm going after this. I'm cultivating and stirring faith in my life, right? Because I'm a new creation. I may still be in an old body. But my mind's being renewed. Okay? I'm doing what David did when he encouraged himself in the Lord. And David had a lot of reasons to give up. Whew, you talk about somebody who could give up. You know, I mean, good grief. The king tries to kill him. Right? His brothers make fun of him, you know. His wife leaves him because he worships too much. His own son takes the kingdom away from him. That's a bad family life. Right? Some of us think we have dysfunctional families. Oh my gosh. You ain't seen nothing. But you know, David just kept on. He kept encouraging himself in the Lord. And he, remember last week, he journaled. Now, I'm not saying that your journals will ever become scripture, so don't. But literally, the things that David heard from the Lord and poured out to his heart became scripture that have encouraged multitudes and millions throughout history. And David just kept on moving forward. We read that in scripture. Those that overcame, because they, in the new covenant, they understood, God, you've given me this new heart. And even with a new heart, it's being purified as my mind is being renewed. It's being purified as I walk a faith walk. I don't think we have enough teaching in the body of Christ right now on faith. Well, I guess we do if you listen to the right stuff. But sometimes we forget what faith looks like. And that there is a walk of faith that enables us to be victorious and to overcome. So I want to challenge you today. Your homework, right? Encourage yourself in the Word of God. Right. You know what? You might, some of you have some of those old books with God's promises. Pull some of those out. Start reading those things and confess them over your life. Right? If you don't know what to confess, email me. I'll have my assistant email you back. Right. It'll be me. But let's move and live understanding that we're new creation realities. Right? Your new normal is righteousness. Your new normal is to hunger after God and to pursue Him. Amen. Let's stand this morning. Let's stand together. Lord, I want to thank you today for the reality that we can live in, that we're new creation realities. Father, you've made us new. And Lord, today, Lord, we just choose to sow righteousness into our hearts. Father, we choose to walk a faith walk today. Father, even when it's challenging, Lord, it's always going to be challenging. But Lord, I thank you that your grace is sufficient, and it's more than enough for all of us to live in today. Father, I just decree today that we are righteous. Father, that we hunger for righteousness. It is the new normal that we live in. And so, Father, I thank you that it is easy to pursue you. Father, even when obstacles come, Father, there's so much that happens when we pursue you. Lord, I thank you for faith. There is a force of faith that's arising in each one of our hearts today. There's a hunger and a pursuit today. Father, we thank you. Father, thank you that we're righteous. Thank you that we're holy. Father, thank you that we're beloved. Thank you that we're sheep that hear your voice and we're known by you and we follow after you. Thank you for that new covenant reality by the Holy Spirit. Father, thank you that you've written on our hearts these truths today. And they are real, they are active, and they are living in all of our lives today. Father, thank you. Breathe your life on us even right now. Holy Spirit, breathe on us today. Breathe your breath, fresh wind, fresh impartation on each one of us today. Father, to live as overcomers. And Jesus, we fix our eyes on you today and we run after you. Thank you, God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. He is good. Okay. I believe Dwayne has a word of knowledge. So, Dwayne, I knew that by the Spirit. No, Jamie, tell me. Same thing.
I promise you this is the weirdest one I've ever got. So when we were praying, I felt the Lord said that he wanted to heal those that could not touch during the virus. There are some people, their love language is touch. And it wounded them that they could not hug people they love. And if that's you, we'd like to pray for you. Because I felt it, and I had to stop thinking about it because it overwhelmed me. So if that's you, we would like to pray for you. Anybody like that? I don't mind missing by 10 miles, I promise you. But if it is, we're just where you're at. We'll pray around you. You can stay there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well. Anybody raise your hand? Yes, okay. Yeah. So just gather around those that are mm-hmm. there. We're gonna pray mm-hmm. for you. Father, we just thank you, God, yes. that you know our hearts. You know how you made us. You so love us. And Father, we just release that healing power right now on those that their love language is to touch and to hug. It's how they feel you and how they feel the passion of people. We just release that healing now in Jesus' name. Father, just take that pain, any trauma that came from not being able to love and hug, not being able to touch. God, any rejection that tried to enter in, we just release all that rejection right now in Jesus' name. And we speak peace over their spirit. We release peace in Jesus' name. Peace, peace, peace. Just breathe in peace. Breathe in peace. Breathe in peace. Just take that peace in. Take that peace in. Just remember, it wasn't personal. Some days it felt personal because it, when that's your love language, it slams you. It really hits you. It wasn't personal. Big, deep breath. Big, deep breath. Breathe that in. Peace, peace, peace. Lisa, how do you feel? Better, worse? Better? Better than cheesecake? I love cheesecake. How about you, Miss Mary? Better? Yeah, it was big. It was over. How about you? How you feeling? Better? How about her? Better? No? Huh? Father, we just release that peace in Jesus' name. Just release that peace in Jesus' name. And we just believe that through the day it's going to continue to really increase. We just continue that in Jesus' name.